he visited Richard Causton at his Buddhist center in Richmond and spoke about what Buddhism means to him. He openly connects it to worldly success and practical problem solving.
Originally, I started this practice because a very attractive young lady told me that the problems that I thought were insurmountable in my life were merely obstacles. I began to practice, and she now, after 14 years, is my wife. I had two major problems, and the fact that I had not been involved in a successful, satisfying relationship with a woman up until that point was the third. The first two were that I had studied 4 years in a very rigorous program at the University of Washington, bent on becoming a stage actor. I was told by all my comrades and my friends and my, you know, teachers, etc., that I had a brilliant career ahead of me. And then a couple of months prior to graduation, I'd ruptured both my vocal cords and was told that I not only was not going to be an actor for my career, but that I would probably not speak normally again the rest of my life. That was devastating. Those three things are what I applied this practice to. So I chanted very specifically the Nam-myoho-renge-kyo in the morning and evening part of the practice, the Gong-yo, to solve those three problems. And within 4 months, I had received a permanent deferment from the armed forces with no explanation. I was back on stage in a musical, which I invited my throat specialist to the first night just so he could see the effects where his own efforts had failed. A good 80% of the reason that I practice Buddhism now is because I can't stand the thought of other people having problems that I know this practice can solve. And when you're a Buddhist, you find you have an arsenal, this immense first aid kit, you know, that not only solves the problem as it appears, but it goes to the root of the problem and solves the original cause. This practice is not easy to do. In the fact that it requires a lot of effort, and it requires it on a consistent basis, morning and evening. So everything that I've seen transform in my career for the better, for the better, for the better, has been as a direct result of me challenging it with this practice.
Well, Buddhism, of course, reflects, obviously, the general nature and character of the people concerned, but it brings out the best in them. So I've, of course, been to America and been to activities there, and what Patrick says is quite right. It brings out the greatness, really, in people. And America still has that pioneering spirit. So people in America will grasp this Buddhism much quicker than we will in Europe.
In the early parts of the practice in Japan, the value creation theory that it was based on partially was gain. And, you know, gain, the word gain has to have an evolutionary definition depending on the level of the life of the person trying to decide it. Gain for a 10-year-old is one thing. Gain for a 15-year-old is another. And gain for a 40-year-old is a different definition. But the point is that the idea of gain propels you forward to practice. And if, in my opinion, especially in America, which we're very gain-oriented, right, is that if somebody needs to be told, well, if you need a new car, chant for a new car. If that will get them to practice, if that will get them to instigate this Buddha nature to start to show itself in all the other areas of their life, then why shouldn't they chant for a new car? Eventually, they're going to realize that the new car is not the source of their happiness. The source of their happiness lies somewhere else, but they've gained the wisdom to see that.